Hi, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us for our first evening program of 2021. I'm so happy that we can come together virtually for this members event, a curator's talk with Andrea Sánchez Ibarrola. Last year was incredibly challenging, but I was consistently surprised and delighted by the commitment and generosity of our members. Many of you renewed your support after years of membership, and others have newly joined us, so welcome. Your membership really makes a difference, especially during this critical time, making our exhibitions and programs possible. So thank you so much for all that you do to support us here at the Polygon and to support the visual arts. We're so grateful to be part of such a passionate community and group of supporters. So for the talk this evening, Andrea will be taking questions at the end, so feel free to pose them using the chat function, and I also received some via email earlier, so thank you. And now I will pass it over to Helga Pakasar, the ordained chief curator.
Hi. So thanks for joining us tonight. I'd first like to just acknowledge that we're located on and occupy the unceded Indigenous territories of the Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh, and Musqueam nations. And we're very grateful to be able to work and live on these lands. I also very much want to extend a heartfelt thank you to Andrea for all her diligence in producing the exhibition here that from Mexico City, despite so many unanticipated and challenging pandemic conditions. I hope you'll have a chance to see the exhibition that closes on February 7th. And also Andrea is hosting a conversation with the five artists tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. It's in Spanish, but it will be followed with a subtitled version. So look out for that. I want to just briefly introduce Andrea, who's an MA candidate in curatorial and critical studies at UBC. Her exhibition at the Polygon really benefited from financial support from the Kelly Foundation, the Ondane Endowment for Curatorial Studies through the Department of Art History, Visual Art and Theory in collaboration with the Morris and Helen Belkin Art Gallery at the University of British Columbia. So it was really all of this incredible support that was crucial to making this exhibition. So thank you. I also want to extend a thank you to the Polygon team who really overcame the unanticipated difficulties of producing the exhibition through remote technologies. So that was like a special effort. Thank you. Andrea has a degree in art restoration and has worked for community-oriented and contemporary art conservation projects. She's worked at leading contemporary art institutions in Mexico, such as MUAC, which is at the National Autonomous University, as well as the Fundación Jumex. This past October, she curated an exhibition roughly translated as Seeing Pandemics Differently for the photo festival Mirar Distinto that focused on photojournalistic coverage of the pandemic. Andrea is currently working on The Skin of Memory, an art project concerned with memory, identity, and trauma through photography, painting, and as well as writing. So Andrea, I turn this over to you now.
Thank you so much, Helga, for your words and your introduction. And I also want to thank everyone here for joining me and joining us in this virtual space. And before I begin, I also want to express my profound gratitude with everyone that has been supporting this project. As Helga mentioned, the Department of Art History, Visual Art and Theory, the Belkin Gallery, and with the support of the Kelly Foundation and the Ondane Endowment for Curatorial Studies, but also everyone at the Polygon. I really, really appreciate your support for making this happening. And the artists, of course, but also many curators, artists, friends, everyone who has made this possible Thank you so much. Let me just share my screen to get going. Okay. So tonight I will speak a little bit about where this project is coming from, to give some background and explain some of the questions to which it responds, explain some of the concepts that structure my curatorial proposition and the ideas that I'm trying to weave through the exhibition by commenting briefly on the artwork. So this project began actually with a single question that, wait a second, why is this not changing? Okay, here we go. So my question, my initial question is it possible to photograph absence? So if photography deals inevitably with what is of the order of presence, like objects, matter, subjects, because it's a very optical phenomenon of photography that is involved with the very physicality of what is there, how then could we photograph what is not there? But rather than a philosophical question, I was interested in absence, in the visuality of absence. So this could also be phrased as, how can we render visible the invisibility of absence? And these two concepts, but the dichotomy, presence, absence, visibility, invisibility, is what structures my my research, my project. But why absence and why invisibility, and specifically why photography? This is what I want to explain a bit, and I need to provide a bit of the context of where this is coming from. So I will borrow from this recently published a story by the independent journalist collective in Mexico, El Quinto Elemento Lab, who published this series, Crisis Forense, Forensic Crisis, that reveals very important consequences of the growing violence in Mexico throughout the past 16 years or so, since 2006, when the war on drugs began, which was the militarization of the country to respond to organized crime and the changing in drug policies. The story focuses on the collapse of the Mexican Forensic Service, and it describes a country that has been exceeded by its deaths. But I would say that rather than only exceeded by the deaths, it exceeded by absence, by the pain that remains, by the absence of over 289,000 of people killed and over 33,000 of people missing, or as we say in Spanish, desaparecidos, which is a word that actually points out to the invisibility of the people who are missing. Now, the paradox, and this can be thought of in terms of presence and absence, is that while there is an exceeding number of unidentified bodies, of present bodies in the which is being dealt with through the forensic services, either like waiting in this over exceeded morgues and most likely in collective graves. The paradox is that parallelly, there is a massive number of people who are searching for their missing ones, for their absent people. As described in this story, also recently published in a Canadian media, a story by Felix Marquez and Nolan, there is a large number of families of victims, of people, of the society that's organized in searching for their missing people. They are self-taught, self-organized, and with their own resources, they carry on the tasks that are actually from the state to carry, the forensic tasks, facing many challenges, many dangers, dealing with the criminal groups, but also corrupt authorities. This specific story tells about Colinas de Santa Fe in Veracruz, which apparently is one of the largest clandestine graves in Latin America. But this is the reality throughout the country. This is why I say that Mexico is a land that it has literally been seeded by dead, by the absence of these dead. And as I said, the paradox is that in this collapse system, as El Quinto Elemento pointed out, their answers could be found. Their answers could be found in this collapsed forensic system. Because here in Mexico, it's very likely that the missing people will disappear twice, alive and dead. So I'm thinking of how can we portray this? It's thinking around enforced disappearance and absence that I'm questioning. How can we render visible this absence, this pain, all the unmourned deaths and all these unhealing wounds? And it's because of the impossibility of seeing that I'm questioning this. But why specifically through photographic medium? To think of that, we need to understand that violence is always expressive. Violence is always an expression of power. It's a message of domination. It's a statement. And the public display of death and horror is part of this disciplinary strategy to control society in fear. Knowing this, we can understand how the type of violence that has been unfolding in Mexico is one to which the creation of images of horror is crucial. It's a strategy. Like the image of thousands of people missing or this clandestine race, but also other way more sinister images. So over the past years, all sorts of images, textual, visual, verbal, of the most gruesome violence have been oversaturating our imaginaries. Photographic images, however, I would say that play a protagonist role in the visual economy, which responds, in my opinion, to two main factors. On the one side, a traditional approach to photography as evidence or proof that predominates among news media and documentary practices, but also the ubiquity of lens-based media and the immediacy with which this media circulates. And in this regard, it's interesting to consider that the time period while this is occurring is precisely the time when we're experiencing these communication shifts in the way we circulate information, with the rise of social media platforms, of online blogs, of instant messaging apps, and so on. Now more than ever, I would say that a communication is visual, but especially it's instantaneous and pervasive. So together, these circuits and photographic images provide the means for the mass reproduction of violence and the dissemination of the message of violence, which raises another paradox. Because while images have been very powerful instruments to visibilize the crisis, to denounce atrocity, claim justice, to inform and raise awareness, they have also been strategically used to shock, to traumatize, to hurt. Even if it's not purposefully for the use of images for this, images inevitably represent and reproduce violence, even if in a mediated way. And this is why I find very relevant to question the role that images have played in these wars, but also to analyze the dynamics of visibility, the dynamics of violence and media from the perspective of visibility and invisibility. Like the tensions that occur between these indelible images that you can't erase from your mind versus the blinding images that are just unbearable to look at, the ones that makes us close our eyes, or the hypervisibility in re-traumatizing sensationalist pressed images versus the invisibility and censorship of critical denouncing voices in journalism, or the invisibility that comes with the synesthetizing effect of seeing this every day, of everyday hearing and experience of violence, which is the first step into the normalization of it. And this is precisely why I've been interested in searching for miradas alternas, for different ways of rendering visible violence. I've been searching for photographic languages that will speak to this crisis without explicitly showing, in a way that allows us to see. And thinking about violence through visuality has been also determinant in my decision to work this project with a gender perspective and focus strongly in works that address femicide. Because while it's true that violence in Mexico has been exacerbated throughout society, and actually statistically, some would argue that it's largely, well, not some would argue, it's a fact, right? That it's largely men who are victims. It's also undeniable that violence violence against women has increased exponentially. But rather than focusing on numbers or tendencies, what I'm interested, as I said, is in the dynamics of visibility and invisibility that rises. And in this sense, the particular forms of violence against women have become ever more sinister and more cruel and macabre. This is evident, for example, when seeing the different approaches into images of women's victims, which are usually images where women's bodies are sexualized and portrayed with a moralizing narrative suggesting that the victim is to blame, which is another way of diverting visibility of the issue compared to the treatment in other images. And this, there's a theorist, Rita Segato, who argues that this is actually closely related with the dynamics of violence in this type of disputes, because it is in women's bodies where violence are disputed as if a territory. Wars are fought in and through women's bodies. And the exhibition of traumatized corporealities of her operate as this punitive message that reaffirms power and this virile dominance. But also femicide and violence against women has a much longer and pervasive history that has been largely invisibilized. In macho societies, patriarchal societies like Mexican, so many aspects of violence against women have become absolutely interiorized into culture that are absolutely invisible. And also it is right at the time of this protest in the summer of 2009 when I'm doing this research, and my awareness is heightening around the invisibilities of violence against women. For example, issues around the inequality of labor in media and journalism and photography, which has been traditionally a male dominant field. And this is also a reason why I choose to focus in making this exhibition and focusing in her lens, right? In women's photographers' work to honor their commitment and their tenacity to face these challenges and continue doing their work despite so many more challenges that these women photographers are facing. So these are some of the thoughts that I was thinking about the visuality of violence in Mexico, about its media representation, about presence and absence, invisibility and invisibility. And I was actually searching for these other ways of seeing. My question was how to represent violence without re-executing, without reproducing violence, but how to avoid this explicit images without incurring in this self-censoring discourse of the unrepresentable, because then we are also falling into the invisibilization of violence. So neither that or a moral-based critique of what is obscene. How could we render visible violence without partaking in the spiral of violence? And at the very beginning of my project, I considered using a comparative approach and maybe bringing into the exhibition space press, photography, and arts, visual arts. But I figured that wouldn't be purposeful. Fruitful for this purpose. And instead, I decided to focus in works that have been created at the intersections of both practices. I became interested in work that merges these two approaches to photography and that would operate at the intersections of the document and the expression. So photographs that would be both evidence, but also interpretation, that would be informative, but also effective, or simultaneously metaphorical and literal. And in this sense, the notion of absence and invisibility was very fruitful in a way to push the limits, so to speak, of the medium of photography by forcing photography to make explicitly visible something that does not pertain to visuality, like absence, but also like affects, like fear, as in Coral Carvalho's work, or grief, in Marisa Hurtado's project. And so with this in mind, I came across the work of Alvarado, Zaragoza, Carvalho, Hurtado, Madrigal, who happen to have many similar concerns and have been thinking around the issues similar to mine, around the representation of violence, around the violence intrinsic in photography, but also around the misrepresentation of women and the objectification of women's bodies and images, also the underrepresentation of women's gazes in the photographic scene. So I found resonance in their work with many of the concerns I was dealing with. And I found in them also a very strong work and a very creative way to deal with this situation. I really do find that their work is offering different ways of telling stories in a way that is very empathetic and caring. So for instance, in the work of Marisa Huertal, precisely empathy is crucial to her practice. Empathy, but also trust and consent. And I would say that her approach to photography is as much about storytelling as it is about building community and solidarity. In this project, Letters to Gemma, she tells us about Gemma Mabil, who is a victim of enforced disappearing and who's been missing since 2011. But she works this project in very close participation with Gemma's parents and in a very intimate way, in a very humane. She's describing her experience of this project as this very intimate process in which she gets to know Gemma. And in a way, she's inviting us also to know her story, to know her face, her name, her identity. And this is also important as a way to render visible, because just the term victim or a number in statistics is, it doesn't really tell you much about the person, and each person counts. Each person is being waited for, and it's an unhealed wound. So Hortal is inviting us to meet in this very intimate way. That's why she presents her project as a photo book also. In her project, she gathers photography, but also poetry written by Gemma, but in the form of a letter, but also, by Hortal, but also poetry written by Gemma. And in this sense, you know, there's this collaborative approach to the project. And she's interested in the experience of this intimate moment of meeting her in this photo book where she presents her work. Differently, Sonia Madrigal's project, Death Rises in the East, which also addresses femicide, but like in the larger scene, she's working in Ciudad Neza in the eastern periphery of Mexico's greater metropolitan area where she's based. And she follows, in part of her work, she follows a performative strategy to render visible absence, but also to claim presence. So her project, which is developed through three lines of work, she's making documentary photographs of protests and rallies organized mainly by family victims of femicide. But she's also developing a collaborative online mapping. And she's doing these interventions, which I was describing earlier as this performative approach to photography, in which she goes out into the territory and places this mirrored image, this mirror silhouette to give an image of women, of femicide victims, but also to claim space and to claim space, to claim presence in the territory. In this way, she's approaching her practice as an act of resistance. And she's reflecting, or she's thinking around the relation between body, territory, and violence. And her experience of traversing the territory or being unable to do so, for instance, which is something also that relates to Coral Carballo's project, Malahora. Coral Carballo was working this project at the time in Veracruz, where she was working as a photojournalist. And her project responds to these unofficial curfews that were circulated mainly through messaging apps or through social media, encouraging people to stay at home in a self curfew to prevent deathly dangers, like the image shown right now here. She reproduces and accompanies her photographs. So in response to these curfews, which of course operate through fear, she goes out to the street, resisting to that imprisoning control, and documents the street, questioning herself, what is it happening? Where is fear? Where can we see fear? Or what is going on that we're so terrorized or so afraid of actually going out? And this is what she wants to render visible in her images. The atmosphere, perhaps you could say, of fear, but also to render visible the very powerful effect of terror on the social body of Veracruz. And she's also interested in the bodily experience of these affects, which is from the position where she's working. She's working this in also as a way to process her experience of violence and her experience of grief for the loss of not only beloved persons, but the loss of life and the loss of life as it was before this violent crisis occurred, in this very bodily experience of it. And she's inviting also people to experience that in the way she suggested the installation. She was very participative in commenting how she was expecting visitors to experience her work on the gallery. For instance, in the uncomfortable gesture of bending down to read the text, or in not being able to look at images that were placed further up on the wall. And also thinking about the experience of violence, there's Aragon's work is dealing with this, but from also considering around the intersections of violence, memory, representation, and identity. Taking this in mind, she's thinking about her experience of growing up in Ciudad Juarez in the moment when feminicide became systematic in the 90s. So she develops this project titled Premonitory Self-Portrait in response to her question of why to place upon women's bodies the weight of violence in representation. But she's also thinking about time and the disruption of time from the effect of violence, the non-linearity, the frozen time. And she's using, or she's borrowing from film language or from film, the idea of time linearity and the still image as this frozen moment. And that's why she's working with this still images subtitled as in the movie to create a self-portrait, which is interesting because none of the images portray her or anybody. Instead, she says it's the landscape that takes the place of the body. And media images, she says, takes the place of memory or identity. But it's also in the subtitle that another image rises, and it's in the juxtaposition of both where her image appears, so to speak. And I'm also interested in her idea around the premonition and this time loop that she creates that relates also to the experience of violence and the way she represents this in her self-portrait. Sonia Madrigal's work, which relates to Aragón's in the sense of portraying this invisible aspects like of violence, like the normalization or the acculturalization of violence. In this case, she's documenting this romantic graffiti, like I love you, I miss you, and name tags of this apparently romantic declarations of love, which can also be understood. Sonia juxtaposes this with statistical facts of femicide in the region to confront this discourse with misogynist society that is constantly killing women in our society. And this idea about flipping the discourse is why she chooses to show this work besides the film as postcards. So you receive part of the image or the information through the visual representation on them, the documentation of this graffitis, but it's complemented and contrasted with information on the backside of the postcards. And lastly, we have Julián Alvarado's work. Like many of the artists in the exhibition, she's also using language and constructing her image around language and using landscape as perhaps a metaphor of the body. She describes her work as a way to create an allegory for the situation of many women in the country, which is in a state of abandonment and desolation, of neglect. And in here, she makes this arrangement of landscapes with these roadside diners that are all named after women as a way to evoke for them, but also to hint at the socially expected role of women, of hospitality, of care, of nourishment. So she's contrasting this through the name of the cafes, and then using the body of these architectural or these architectural bodies as a way to represent them and evoke absence. So I don't want to spend too much, and I'm very bad at keeping track of my time, but. This is some of the ideas that I've been having in mind when I've been going through work, through photographic work. And I found that the strategies that these artists use, for instance, this performative approach to photography, but also the use of language and the way they construct their images through like poetic resources, but also creating these allegories and metaphors that really do provide different ways of rendering visible and to tell stories. I believe that these are, I would say, a different way of seeing, a different way of rendering the situation. And what I think important about this is that for me, I do believe images are a way of structuring thought and a way of thinking through things. And this is precisely the idea behind this project. It's been a project where I've wanted to think of this situation, but also as a way to question reality and to question the crisis that we are going through, hoping that this will open up possibilities to understand and hopefully build in some change. And there's this phrase that I have right here at the back of this presentation that has been staying with me throughout this project by Rancière, who writes, the images of art do not supply battles for weapons, but they don't supply weapons for battles, sorry, but they do help sketch new configurations of what can be seen, of what can be said, and what can be thought, and therefore a new landscape of the possible. This might be perhaps maybe too high expectations. I'm not being naive, but I do think that opening the possibility of seeing reality and seeing a crisis is a step towards thinking it through, of critically thinking it through, and hopefully working towards building a different landscape, a different social landscape, and different possibilities. This has been some of the ideas that I've been having, and some of the goals of this exhibition is just to invite the visitors to, well, just perhaps in a way to raise awareness, but also to instigate criticality of these invisibilities of the violence, not only in Mexico, but also elsewhere, because it's a situation that is pervasive throughout throughout society, and also to continue thinking around the challenges in representation of these subjects and the representation of violence, which I do think there's no wrong or right answers. There's just different contexts, different needs, different circumstances. And I guess it's a never-ending process to continue to look for miradas alternas, perhaps, or for different ways of rendering visible. I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to stop my share screen. And I am absolutely not keeping track of time. Where do I stop this here? Okay. Has it stopped? Yes, it did.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much, Andrea. And we definitely welcome your questions. So you please feel free to type them into the chat. But I did have one question emailed to me in advance. So perhaps we'll start there. So I can read it, but I've also sent it to you in the chat, Andrea. So it says, they're asking, this is from Elizabeth, to curate the pain of societal oppression, one has to empathize with the pain of the individual experience, the grief of families of missing and murdered women when losing a child or parent. For these exhibitions, do galleries do enough to create a human-centered experience for audiences? How might we ground audiences in the stake of this loss? What more should or could we do to create opportunities to empathize with others?
Yes, this type of issues is one that I've been thinking about a lot when working this project. And one of the things I do believe is that it's very important to create spaces of dialogue. Like ideally this, for instance, when I was thinking about this project, this was a huge concern for me, because for me, like, what's the purpose of just showing images, of just exhibiting the pain, exhibiting the crisis, this idea of making things visible, especially with the dislocation, the geographic dislocation of why would I bring this into view here? And what I do think is that the curatorial work and exhibition making it's a medium to open up spaces of conversation and hopefully empathetic conversation. Now, how can we do it in a safe, caring environment? I do think it's, I would say maybe that it's always important to keep in mind, to be mindful of the other and of your own possibilities, to be respectful, to be, mindful that the stories that you will tell and the stories that you will hear, you will always be receiving them from your own positionality, your own experience, and your own affects and an affective experience. And I would say it's just a way, or I would just think that a key thing is to remain open and receptive to the other. But it is definitely very delicate. And there is a lot of questions, ethical questions around not only photographing violence, but exhibiting violence, or exhibiting these stories, right? And as I said, I do think that there are no right of or wrong answers. This has been a major concern for me when developing this project. Constantly, I would question myself, why would I bring this particular subject into an exhibition here, right? Like also outside of my country. And regarding this, I thought, well, as part of the academic process, of the learning process in my MA program, and discussing it in my practicum with my professors and colleagues and cohort. And first I was very apprehensive about well, maybe this should be a very academic approach and we can do symposia and you know, like studying events and reading groups and so on. There's so much that you can do, but at the end of the day, I think it's more about remaining very open and receptive to the other. I think so far that's one of my reflections.
Thank you. Do you have any other questions from our audience? If not, I have a question for you. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to perhaps the scope of the exhibition and whether things changed from when you had the initial idea to when you started researching and the exhibition was coming together. And sort of to build on that, I know you were moving between Mexico and Canada, so whether that movement between the two places also had an effect on your thinking of the project.
Well, I think, yes, well, in a way it did, because in the very early stages, I was thinking about just addressing the situation of enforced disappearing and the violent crisis, like, just as a whole in the country. And as I said, just being here in the summer of 2019 was one of those things that shifted, for instance, into the gender perspective of the project. Because it was a moment when where there was like this momentum or this rise in the feminist protests against violence that was very, very, it's like an awakening perhaps, but also it really it pointed this urge of committing also into creating this just making perhaps a statement of honoring the work of these women photographers. So that's one of the things that changed. Also in this back and forth, it was like coming into Vancouver to study. It was very surprising and revealing learning when I did decide to focus on femicide as a main focus of the project, to start learning around the situation of missing and murdered Indigenous women in Canada. And that has also been very like mind-opening for me or very revealing, because there's also other dynamics of invisibility that occur. Mm-hmm. The ones, like, we're so close and so related as societies and countries, but yet, like here in Mexico, we don't hear anything about that crisis. And I believe that in Canada, there's very little visibility of what is happening here. And yet there's so many things uncommon. So that was also something that at some point I did consider, well, perhaps I should address both situations. I decided not to, because I'm not informed enough and I didn't want to create a project that would in any way compare femicide in one place versus the other. I did not want to create that. But that was something also that I would say it's part of the movement of the consequences of moving back and forth or that working this project in this like in two places at the time. But other than that, I think I did stick throughout like my research with a very precise idea. I was very interested in photography and the visual representation of absence and that did really remain throughout the entire project. And in that sense, no, it didn't really quite change.
Any other questions? Let's see. Well, I have another one for you. You said something during your talk, referencing the text in one of the pieces as sort of conjuring up another image. And I thought that was a really interesting way to put it. And I found the relationship between text and image really powerful throughout the show. And I was wondering if you could just speak a little bit more about the role that the text plays for sure. Many of these works.
Yes, let me share again my screen. I think it's better to have these images on. So yes, text, the resource of text, but not only text, but I would say language is something that many of these artists make use of. But this particular project by Alejandra Aragon, Premonitory Self-Portrait, it is something that interests me also a lot, of how she is creating different images or evoking different images through the subtitles. So in here, her work is a self-portrait, so we need to understand that first. And so it's a presentation of who she is. And who she is, she's dealing also with issues of memory, of anecdote, but she's also bringing in like her family history, but also, as she says, media representations of who she has become throughout time. She works this project as revisiting places of her youth and then like capturing hints of those places and those things that determine who she is now. This is why she's also dealing with the premonition. And here text, it's actually a long writing in which it's all written in this self-affirmative sentence. So she says, for instance, I am Marguerite Duras on page 15 of her text, The Lover, or I am Claire Danes and Kate Winslet kissing Leonardo DiCaprio, or I am my grandmother wearing her flower dress. So it's interesting, these very brief sentences, self-affirming sentences, that you start having a notion of who she is, of what she has lived, of reference to the popular culture that has made an impact of her. So perhaps in her idea of romantic love, right? Or in or her relationship with her transgenerational relationship of women in her family. But also she points to like violent episodes in Ciudad Juarez or experiences of her own. For instance, I am the moment when I refused to get into that car and he spit at me. Or I am the mother of, I can't remember her name right now, it's the name of a victim of femicide, one of the very first or the very early femicide cases in Ciudad Juarez in the 90s. And she says, I am her mother who still claims for justice. So she has this, you need to read through the entire series of prints and through the subtitles to really have this picture of her or her portrait. And they are contrasted with the images of these places where she actually grew up in. And that's what in the vitrine, what the map points to. There is a map of Ciudad Juarez, which is marked with notes of her, like memories of her, so and notes of pointing to like this route that she made, revisiting these places of her youth, of her teenage years, right? And she, so this map is the one that I'm pointing out to, is also describing or pointing to the locations where the prints or where the photos are made, where these landscapes are made. And for her, it is definitely a very mindful decision to not represent anybody, to only use landscape and to use architecture to evoke this state of neglect of Ciudad Juarez, but also of violence against women. I don't know if I'm explaining a bit of what you were asking to.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, I see we have a question from the audience, from Bill. The placement of the cafe images in a grid immediately brought to mind the work of the Bechers, which depicted industrial landscape as archetypes through repetition. Was this your intention or the artist's?
Well, definitely not mine. I'm not pointing out to the bachelor's, but the grid is, so she worked this series, and one of the questions I had for Juliana when I interviewed her was if it was a longer series, if it was only 9 prints, and she said that this project was only this very 9 prints. And I think, I don't know if she has that reference in particular, but I do definitely know that she's very mindful of the formal or the aesthetic result of this very geometrical and rhythmic composition, for sure. But I would be lying if I say that she is taking that reference.
I had a question for you. Yes. Are you're joining us from Mexico City?
Yes, I am.
I was wondering if you could just tell us a little bit about how you're spending your days and maybe if you're reading anything interesting right now.
I am. Well, I'm spending my days embracing uncertainty for sure and reinventing the future, because it is an odd time to be graduating from university, from grad school, in a moment when we don't know what's going to happen next, and there's very little opportunities here in Mexico City. Museums are closed, mm-hmm. and there is there's a lot of budget cuts, so it's not a very appealing scenery ahead. But I am spending my days mainly at home and working a bit. But reading, I have been reading a couple of books that actually speak to also memory and the invisibilization of women, actually. So recently I'm reading this book by Spanish writer, don't know the name, but it's titled La ridícula idea de no volverte a ver. So the ridiculous idea of not seeing you again, which is, it's a biography of Marie Curie, the scientist, married to Pierre Curie. And it's also a diary of her own experience or herself, not a biography, but the author writes about the experience of losing a husband, which is also the moment that in the life of Marie Curie that she is, for she's departing from, but she's weaving in also the life of these women scientists and how her work is traversed by like many, many things that are not really accounted for in her biographies. And she's bringing in like grief and into the story, but also loss and the experience of that. I was mixing the two books. I'm reading two books at the time. That was one, and the other is Lo que Olvidamos, What We Forget, which is a very beautiful short novel about the loss of memory in the relation of daughter and her mother.
It's good.
I needed to take a break from violence and femicide, for sure.
It's a good time to catch up on some reading.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, well, we have another audience question. This is from Liza. I'm curious about the curating process. For instance, was there a call for art for this exhibit, or did you already have these artists in mind when you were doing research? And will tomorrow be the first time they all meet each other?
Okay, so So it was not a call for artists. This project was developed, I don't know anyways, this project was developed as part of my MA program in curatorial studies at UBC. And so the selection of artists was part of my research process, actually. And part of the research I did over the summer. So it was definitely a fast-paced experience. I actually didn't know the work of any of them before working in this project. When I spent the summer in Mexico researching for this project, I was at the beginning interested in a much more broad, let's say, like, scope of work, because I was thinking about press photography, but also arts. And it was that moment when I decided that I should, well, it was then when I really came up with, I found this artist who are working at these intersections, and that was also part of the process of defining this. But no, that, how did that process go? Well, yes, I guess I met them through interviews, also like through the Biennale catalogs, interview with curators who, you know, like you talk and you explain like what you're researching on, and then they suggest the work of someone, and then that someone suggests the work of someone else. And in that sense, some of these artists were actually suggested to me by other artists in previous interviews and such. Some of them do know each other and even have collaborated. Some of them do not and have, and tomorrow we'll be meeting each other, like others from the first time. But I would say most of them know each other and what the others are working on, and especially now and in this past year and with the pandemic, there is definitely that happening. I would say that there is this resurgence of networking and connecting through virtuality and let's say like Instagram, and especially like photographers who are working with the documentary, in journalism, in visual storytelling. It's, I would say it's a network that is very tightly connected. And throughout these months of the pandemic, there's also, like in a way, Latin America, I would say that strength in that, in, through virtuality and through like COVID Latam projects or any sorts of online circuits. So I would say that, that most of them know of each other, maybe not personally or maybe not like so closely, but they are aware of the work of the others for sure.
That's great. I think we have maybe one more question that Michael's gonna send us.
One second, I'm just waiting for Helga.
But if there's any other questions from the audience, please feel free to type it in. Congratulations, Andrea, on your graduation.
Thank you so much. It has been very, very exciting to, and I am very grateful, not with the Polygon, but with everyone, because at some point I really did thought that the pandemic would be maybe interrupting the project and the graduation. And I am very grateful that everyone, with everyone who supported in the possibility of actually accomplishing it. These are challenging times for everyone, for sure.
I'm not getting it, so maybe we should wrap it up here and just remind everyone that the exhibition is on until early February.
Yes, until February 7th. Andrea, thank you so much for being so generous with your time and your insight. I think I really enjoyed your talk, and I'm just so grateful you could join us. And thank you to all of our members and friends who joined us this evening. And as we mentioned before, there is another talk tomorrow in Spanish. So you can visit our website and go to the events page to join us there. So thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you so much. And thank you everyone for joining.